Our reading today comes from Mark 2:17. Jesus heard them and answered, "People who are well do not need a doctor, but only those who are sick. I have not come to call the respectable people, but the outcasts." She's 15, but she's already pregnant. He's 16, and he's already a father. He's 26, and has a serious heroin addiction. She's a 24-year-old single mother working the corner to pay the rent. He's 35, in an unhappy marriage, having an affair. She's 31, and having her third abortion. These are all the people God loves and forgives. God fixes broken. Mark 2:17, Jesus plainly states, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have come to call the righteous. I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners." Contrary to what a large number of people think or feel, God is not one to pick the people who have their lives together. But be careful. God takes broken things and repairs them. Don't judge someone who seems to have everything together. Take, for example, a godly man in history named David. He was a shepherd boy who later in his life became the king of Israel. It's estimated that around the age of 15, David fights the Philistine warrior Goliath. Back in those days, armies chose their best warriors and had them fight rather than having the entire army fight. David was a young boy, and Goliath was a huge, hardened warrior, and yet Goliath fell to David by a sling. David defended God. As Goliath slandered all of Israel, God included, David stood up for what and whom he believed in. Interestingly enough, David later became king and is actually unfaithful to his wife. You must realize, even people that seem to love God will make stupid mistakes. Understand, people will always have their shortcomings, and God loves to be involved with broken people. All throughout the verses of the Bible, you will find people with brokenness and pain, much like you and I might experience even today. Noah was a drunk. Abraham was too old. Isaac was a daydreamer. Jacob was a liar. Joseph was abused. Moses had a stuttering problem. Gideon was afraid. Samson had long hair and was a womanizer. Rahab was a prostitute. David had an affair and was a murderer. Elijah was suicidal. Isaiah preached naked. Jonah ran from God. Job went bankrupt. Peter denied Christ. I am broken. I'm not seen as a whole person anymore because of the chair. Because I can't do what others are able to do. Because in this society, when you have a disability, you are seen as a burden on society. But God does not see it that way. God is using me to do his work. Never in a million years did I ever think that I would be preaching God's word in front of people. where no one can see me, where no one can see my disability. But God took me out of my comfort zone and has me show others that I can do this through God's strength. God wants others to see that even though I am broken, I can still do God's work. By others seeing me and all that I go through, He is showing His strength and His love for me and for others through me. God wants me to show all my cracks and scars that life has given me. All those cracks and scars show I have been through, show what I have been through and survived, and they show that God does forgive and God does love the sinner. Our God fills in our cracks and puts our broken pieces back together with something more beautiful and precious than gold, in order to show the world that we believe in a God who fixes the broken things. We need to bear our scars in our lives and wear them proudly. The world is full of broken things, broken bones, broken windows, little birds with broken wings, not to mention broken hearts and broken homes, broken marriages, broken dreams, and broken lives. In some way, we are all broken. It is whether we embrace that brokenness and allow God to do His work is the difference. Most of us don't want to allow others to see that we are broken, that we have flaws. We have to put on a mask of perfection so that no one can see our weakness. But it is in that weakness that God does His best work. That is when we empty ourselves of ourselves and make room for the Holy Spirit. Others need to see that it's okay to be weak, that it's okay to need help. As God tells us, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Jesus didn't cut the bread, He broke it. He was painting a picture of what was about to happen to His body. It would be violently wounded. It would be torn and mutilated. It would be broken. There is an old saying that I have always liked. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Many times we've set out to make something that is working work a little better, only to end up breaking it where it won't work at all. This is where the saying, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, originated. We may spend our lives trying to fix what is broken, but we must remember, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Yet when our lives are broken, they need fixing. Too often, when something is broken, we spend all our time trying to figure out why it is broken. We have a natural curiosity to know why behind what is happening to us. We ask questions like, if God is an all-good God, why is our world broken? The most difficult thing to understand in life is why pain, why problems, and why suffering are part of it. If we are not careful, contemplating why will leave us bitter and cynical, spending all our time wondering about why our world is broken, does little to mend our broken lives. Job's friends came to him and began contemplating the reason for Job's suffering, but that only made his difficulties more agonizing. Job's wife was agonizing as she exclaimed, "Curse God and die." When God finally spoke to Job, he revealed that Job didn't need to know the why. Even if God were to explain the why, Job couldn't have understood it. As humans, we tend to automatically discard something if it's broken. But for God, it's the exact opposite. God uses broken things and broken people for his purpose. I find the more broken I become, the more God has for me to do, the more God wants me to share. It can be so easy for us to push ourselves to the side and think that we are useless and seen as no good because we're caught up in a particular sin or hanging on to the past. But you know what is amazing? Despite all our flaws, God looks past them and doesn't see what we narrow ourselves down to be, because we are so much more than that. God sees our potential and believes in us. But we need to also believe in ourselves as well. It is through that brokenness that God gives us strength and courage to keep going. It is through our brokenness that others see the light of God through us. Throughout the Bible, we see God using imperfect people for the sake of his mission, to bring hope to the world. I never quite understood why Jesus chose the individuals he did, but I am guessing his reasoning was to further prove the validity of his being. He didn't call them popular, rich, or successful to further his ministry. Rather, the poor, the broken, and the faithful. I can only imagine how confused the Pharisees and religious leaders must have been while looking at the team of people the proclaimed Savior had gathered together. They were a team of misfits, with nothing to lose but everything to gain with God. From an outside perspective, we can see that it didn't matter where people were from, what they had done, or who they used to be. Jesus used all people for the good of his will. God does not want us sinners to pick ourselves up by our bootstraps and try harder. He does not want us to feed our pride by making things right. Nor does he simply want sadness and sorrow over the consequences and pain of our sins brings to us. He wants spiritual brokenness, the kind of brokenness he can use. He wants godly sorrow that leads to repentance. Out of brokenness, out of grief and hurt, of a fractured heart over sin, God longs to produce humility in us. It is humility that allows us to recognize, as David did, who God is and who we are in comparison to him. It is humility that sets us up to come to grips with our sins. God wants us to be like his son, and he is working to conform us to his image. What is hindering us from being like Jesus, you won't like the answer. Because the blessing comes only after we are broken. Brokenness is bitter, but essential for the Holy Spirit to make us like Jesus. It is brokenness that allows us to see that we are not perfect, that we don't have to hide our scars, that we don't have to be ashamed of all that we have been through in our lives. Brokenness opens us up to salvation, to a life with Jesus. The greatest problem that keeps us from experiencing the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives and in our church is not the lack of ability, but it's our stubbornness and lack of brokenness. God cannot work through an individual who is proud, disobedient, and self-centered. God works through the broken. The Holy Spirit is what fills in the cracks and heals our scars. God will not leave us broken. He fills us with the Spirit so that we can shine His light. The reason brokenness is beautiful is because of how God can use it in our lives. It is something that can draw us nearer to Him. Brokenness can make room for a remorseful heart and repentance to bring us back into fellowship with Him when we have miserably failed. It is not lovely in and itself. It is not the end of the journey. It is not a cute hashtag to put on a picture of a dirty house. It's not a word to use when you want to feel authentic. Standing alone, it is messy and sad. No, the beauty in spiritual brokenness is found in where it brings us. True brokenness is a tool by which God brings His wandering sheep back into His loving arms. If you ever feel like you aren't worthy enough to be used by God, let alone loved by Him, just remember that Jesus used a bunch of flawed people to share hope to a flawed and broken world. In God, we find renewal, mending, and purpose. Jesus didn't call the equipped. He equipped the call. And no matter what you've been through in life, remember that same power that conquered the grave lives within you. You are worthy of life. You are worthy of God's love. You are worthy of joy. You are worthy of a fulfilling purpose that will take you places you have never imagined. The beautiful thing is that God is in the business of not only loving broken people, but also sweeping up all the broken pieces and gluing them back together for His purpose. Yes, God uses broken things. Perhaps your life has been broken by sin, but like Humpty Dumpty and the king's horses and men, God can put it back together again. Amen.